when he got into the high street, people were scowling at him. He was seeing these people frowning and looking stern. And then some little street urchins started running behind him and calling out things to him. And when Dad was telling me the story, he suddenly, because he's lying in a hospital bed on a morphine drip, and he hesitated. And I thought, oh, maybe he's just going back to sleep. But I just checked. I said, Dad, what was it calling? And he said, they were saying, your dad's your mum. And Dad said he was so embarrassed and humiliated that he just, because he was a shy man, and he just ducked down a side street and went back around the block and went home. And so I had this sudden picture, because Dad knew what I did for a living. He knew I was the advocate of fathering and so on. And he was really telling me in this story, I think, we really wanted to. I really wanted to be a hands-on dad. And I think millions of men in the 20th century, their hearts, they wanted to cuddle their babies. They wanted to play. They wanted to play with it.
How had this idea that fathers in particular had to be distant and had to be unemotional, how did that grow up, and how did you try to dismantle it?
Yeah, but I think we just didn't realise the impact. The 20th century, especially the first half of it, was a nightmare for families. Most men were involved in planetary wars, and there were recessions, and there were huge refugee flows across the world. There was hammer blow after hammer blow, and to me as a therapist, something that comes 30 years later is kind of only just after the first one. And dealing with that mostly meant shutting down, perhaps using alcohol to self-medicate, but mostly just not feeling any, becoming very, very numb. And so if a dad who's with his little boy, and his little boy starts to cry because he's seen a dead pet on the road or something, as that boy starts to cry, the nature of our minds is we will want to start crying as well. But that dad thinks he's going to start crying. He's seeing his friend's bodies dismembered in fields of fire. He can't begin to let that out. His experience, his felt experience is that if I start crying, I will never stop. I'll go mad. And so he feels this massive discomfort. And the only way he knows that to fix that is to change the child. And so he'll yell at the boy, or he'll hit the boy with the side of his hand and say, you cut that out, stop sniffling. And so you have that as part of the culture. And because that was so commonplace, came the culture. But the harm that there was that men were not emotionally available to their children. And so as kids grew up, there was a rift. And so one of the things we began to realize was that take 100 men, and I've done this many times, 100 men in the room. 30 of those men barely speak to their fathers. Another 30 have what you might call a prickly relationship. Another 30 would have a token, dutiful, go through the motions. But only 10 men out of 100 are actually close to their dads. Now, I started talking about this in my shows that I do. That was my work for 20 years, was just doing live shows, basically doing group therapy with thousands of people at a time. And as I told these stories, Sarah, it wasn't intentional. I was just trying to explain something. But what I saw in front of me was men starting to weep in the room. And men would sometimes leave. They just would leave. And I'd speak to the ushers afterwards, and they'd say, look, that guy was in tears. He just left in tears. And so we were tapping into some of that pain. And that's important, because if you feel that grief of what's called the father wound that ran like a grand canyon through the culture, feeling it is the first step. And if you get in touch with that, then you will want to be a different dad to your son and your daughter. But I had to lighten up my shows. It's not a good outcome. No, you don't want people to not make it to the end. So, yeah, a lot more humour went in after that.
Do you feel, Steve, that you've witnessed then a cultural reorientation? Like, that description of those kind of stern fathers seems so different from my husband or the fathers I know, this generation and younger. Does it feel like that to you, that you've really witnessed a kind of revolution in the way that dads in particular respond to that?
Absolutely. There's a fantastic redemption of fatherhood, and we see a man pushing a stroller, we barely blink now. That's absolutely normal, and so we fix that. We're mopping up the residuals of messed up masculinity, which oddly seems to be in positions of leadership and power now. So there must
be a bit of work left there to do, I think,
yeah,
Steve. the description of grief, or the acknowledgement of grief that was there for so many men, is partly connected to their own fathers, but bigger than that. And you write in this new book that manhood was partly written out of a grief that you and Sharon have gone through together. What happened during her second pregnancy?
This was a story that I chose to tell in the new book because I was wanting to illustrate something that other people might be able to take some value from, and that was that we had a miscarriage that happened of our second pregnancy, and the timing of it was such that we spent one day in the hospital progressively losing our hope for baby, and then the next day I had to run a weekend training workshop with 18 people, and there wasn't a lot of time. I had enough sense to tell the people, yeah, we've just lost a pregnancy and I'm a bit knocked around, I haven't had much sleep, but I was there for them, and that was my job. And so in the months that followed, I just went into a kind of a very grey place, and because of Sharon's background, I think she was grieving on her own, and it was terrible. It was just the world was just very grey. And one day I wandered out to the seminar room that we had built on our farm where we did our work, and it's a beautiful chapel-like sort of a space with skylights and the light streaming in, and I picked up my guitar and I sat on the floor and I started to do this thing which anyone who plays the piano or plays an instrument, you do this quite often, you just kind of muck about and something comes to you to play. Suddenly I was playing these chords were from a Rolling Stones song, which is, you know, Goodbye Ruby Tuesday, or Ruby Tuesday is the name of the song, and the words are, by Ruby Tuesday, who could hang a name on you? All of a sudden, I was just weeping, and I was bending forwards, my head, you know, arched over the guitar, my head on the floor, tears just streaming out of it, and but the psychologist part of my brain said, I was thinking, whoa, there you go, you know, this really needed to happen, and this is all right. And so I was 99% grief and 1% watching and thinking, this is probably what I needed. And then the cognitive connection, but this was a song, of course, about a girl. And so the grief I had was that we had a son that really, I hadn't admitted this to myself, but it was a daughter that I really wanted. And that in my mind was what we had lost. And so after that, I was a different man, and my heart had opened up again, and I was just a different human being. And we were able to go ahead and in time have, you know, a fantastic daughter, and I wasn't holding anything back. And so that was the case of music being the thing that opened the floodgates. And whatever it is, whether it's listening to other men's stories, I've seen this happen in men's groups, it's just that suddenly everything that was held in is coming through, and it's okay. It's just the natural way our bodies are designed to move through the enormous sadness of being alive in this world.
Well, let's talk more about what our bodies do and what they can tell the other parts of us. This new book begins with a story of a patient, Andy, that you had many years ago. What's her story and why are you including it?
Andy was a patient of mine in the 1980s, and she was a young mum, and she was also a doctor, a GP, and she had an experience where she was in a train station, a suburban train station, in the car park in the middle of the day, and a young man in the distance called out to her, and like most young women and most GPs in those days, her whole character was to be helpful and to be obliging, and this young man was clearly wanting something or needing some sort of help, and he was away off still, but as she was kind of leaning over towards to come see what he wanted. In the very pit of her stomach, as she told me about this experience, a little twinge happened, down in her belly. And she found herself jumping into the car, locking the doors, by now in almost a full state of panic, and screaming out of the car park and thinking to herself, what's the matter with me? And she could see him in the rearview mirror, standing looking in her direction. She didn't understand what on earth was going on. Got home, her little daughters were being minded, and she spent got pretty quickly taken up into the day, put it out of her mind. But that night on the evening news, the headline story of the local news, a young woman coming into that car park, probably just minutes after her, had been assaulted by that man. And when Andy's husband came into the lounge room, he found her sobbing on the couch because she was just putting together. It had almost been her. Was it her fault that it happened to the other young woman? Should she have done something? But it was literally seconds after her leaving. And so she was my patient because several years later, she was still having a lot of post-traumatic stress issues. And part of her rebuilding her own mental health was to start on that foundation, that she had a very wise intuition that had saved her life.
So really, you think it wasn't just luck, it was something active in her that saved her life? Talk me through how that might have happened.
Yes, well, what we know about now, and this is the thing that neuroscience has arrived at, is that our ordinary conscious mind is very focused. Its job is to be focused. It only picks up about 1/100th of what our senses are taking in. Whereas our senses come from our ancient past. It's the wild creature in us that knew when the birds went quiet in the forest, you just waited to see what was going to happen. And so your body is taking in lots and lots of cues all the time. The campus, which is in the center of your brain, is running that past every memory you've ever had. And if there's anything that doesn't fit, it alerts the amygdala, which sits right next door. And the amygdala is an alarm system. And the amygdala sends a message down your vagus nerve, which wraps the vagus nerve in the body, wraps round heart, your stomach, down to your intestines. It goes all over through the midline of your body. And it sends you signals. Now, psychologists call this a sort of parallel processing, but I call it super sense because I think it's amazing. If you go down the middle of your body, there'll be a part of you that is actually thinking, is this guy making sense? Or is this a load of rubbish? Or should I have gone to the bathroom before I did this interview? There's something going on down there. And the thing is, it's not just in emergencies. It's happening all the time. It's happening every second you're alive.
Can we always trust it though, Steve? I mean, sometimes we think our instinct is telling us something, but actually we're just misguided or we don't have enough information.
Absolutely. This is so important. That was my next thing to say, is it's not infallible. We all have baggage. So we all sometimes have signals that are to do with the baggage and are really not the case. And so I have a friend who's a Vietnam veteran in Coffs Harbour, and he was going pretty well, but then he started having anxiety attacks, and it turned out, this was again back in the 80s, he had a Vietnamese family had moved into his street, and he was having anxiety attacks because there was Vietnamese people in his world, and he spent, like every soldier there, spent a lot of time being frightened out of his wits. And he did a brilliant thing, Sarah. He made the connection. He went down and got to know that man and became good friends with them and ended up eating with them. In the end, he actually went back to Vietnam and he taught his own amygdala, if you like, that these are lovely people and I'm absolute. And so always the thing is not to believe your gut feelings. It's just consult with them and say, and you can talk to them, say, is this? And if your stomach clenches a bit more, you're onto something.
You use the metaphor of a four-story mansion to explain how the different parts of us work together. Give me a tour of this, please, Steve. What's going on in different levels of our mansion?
Yes, now this is a beautiful metaphor for the architecture of the mind. and the way the mind works. And on the ground floor, you've got your body, and if it hasn't had breakfast and if it hasn't had a good night's sleep, things are not going to go that well. And also, of course, this is where the wild creature messages are happening as well. So it's a pretty fertile ground down there. You come up one level of the mansion, and that's where your feelings are, your regular, ordinary emotions. And that's kind of like the disco dance floor of your mansion. It's pretty colorful and alive. And as we've said, emotions are really important because they're the things that are your power source for living. But they're also something that you can get stuck in or lost in. And so luckily we've evolved a third floor on our mansion, which is cognitive clarity and reasoning. So if you have someone who's stuck in their feelings, and everyone's got a friend who's just so, you know, emotes all over the place all the time, they're lovely but very tiresome. They really need to go up into their head and do some thinking. You know, what are your options? You know, what are some solutions? How could you do this? Equally, there are people who are trapped on the third floor who think and think and think, and they go, you know, they're just a torrent of words. And they really probably need to go downstairs and get in touch with what's really driving them. They tend to be men and they tend to be boring. So, good idea. Mm. Yeah. Mm.
So that's the first, second and third floor. What's left? What's on the fourth floor?
Yes, well, after a while, you go up on the third floor, there's a bit of a trapdoor in the ceiling. You just suddenly, one day you notice there's a trapdoor in the ceiling and there's a bit of a chink of light coming through, and even, you're not sure, but maybe the sound of birds or music or something. And you go and get a ladder and you shove this trapdoor, it opens up, and what do you know? There's a rooftop garden. Up on the top of your mind, on the imagination of your mind, is this rooftop garden. It's open to the sky. There's nature, there's cosmos spinning above you. There's other people. They're kind of like you. And this is my way of explaining spirituality, that you are not lost in your own little skin. Really, we don't even exist in our own little skin. We're just leaves on the tree. And this is a very freeing thing, Sarah. The reason this is, you know, as a retired psychologist, I come to this, is that you can only function when you have all four floors have got the lights turned on. You have this wonderful mobility and spaciousness inside your own mind, and you can travel up and down at will. And as you do that, you're a unified system. Your mind will unify what you believe in, what you feel, what you think, and what your gut is telling you will begin to point the same way, and that your life will never be the same.
That fourth level of spirituality, or the rooftop garden as you describe it, is that the level that has motivated the advocacy work you've done for refugees over the decades?
One of the things about having Asperger's syndrome, Sarah, is that you don't have a herd instinct, and so you don't get that kind of feeling of going along with the crowd. And I saw this happening for instance in Greta Thunberg's experience, where she learned about climate change, and she decided it was up to her to fix it, that the grown-ups were not addressing something, even though they were acknowledging it was really, really important. I often experienced something very similar. I got enormously distressed in the early 2000s about Australia's treatment of refugees, and a particular tragedy that happened almost 20 years ago this year, which was the CIVEX sinking, where 300 women and children were drowned in a boat. And I was involved in the church, in the Uniting Church in Bellingen, where I live. And some of us had this thing that we just can't let this go, and that for us what that spirituality meant was that they were women and kids who drowned in, you know, on the way to Australia, in an ocean that was crisscrossed by jumbo jets flying routinely to and fro, was under intense surveillance by our government, and I felt I can't be at peace with myself unless I do something about this. The women and children are my life's work, and I'd had to do something. And so with a group of us, we decided that we would build a memorial to those people, because if they'd been Westerners in a jumbo jet that had crashed, there would have been years of inquiries and grief and caring for those people. But they drowned coming here because we had their husbands here in the, our visa laws had meant the husbands couldn't be re, and they were just mums and kids trying to be with their dads. And so what we found happened was, as we began to voice our feelings about this, all over the country, our schools and churches and communities knew what we were talking about. And so we ended up over 4 years building a national memorial that involved 300 pieces of artwork that now stands on the Canberra lakeshore as a memorial to each individual who drowned. Big poles for the adults and little poles for the children with their names on, and with a beautiful artwork. That was the most spiritual thing I've ever done in my life. But it could be surfing that you do. It could be going to rave parties. It could be making music. It could be growing a garden. Spirituality is anything you do which takes you out of yourself. Because out of yourself is a really good place to be.
You're a granddad now. How does that compare to being a dad, being a parent?
Oh, it's probably explains the journey, which if I could be a dad, could have dadhood over again, I would be so much less uptight, Sarah.
You'd be a granddad as a dad, would you?
Yeah, and I think every grandparent would. I was just too worried and too stressed and too worried about, you know, being a breadwinner and those things. And I think that conveys itself to your family. You pass on your stress. And so, yeah, if anyone wants to improve their family that's listening to the program, you know, remember the hurry is the enemy of love. And if you slow down anything in your life, if you slow it down, it'll go better.
That little boy who was running wild on the beaches in Yorkshire, where does that wildness in you get its outlet now in your grandfatherly years?
It's back again, Sarah. Yeah, I'm becoming more of a little boy every day. And I love kayaking, I love swimming in the ocean, and I'm a responsible adult, but I know how to hang loose now, and it's really great.
Steve, thank you so much for being my guest on Conversations.
Thank you for being such a wonderful conversationalist. Thank you. Thank you.
Every time she fell,